Welkom in de third video on life annuities. Here we'll consider guaranteed annuities, increasing annuities, and also we will talk about the valuation, the evaluation of annuity functions. Let us first begin with guaranteed annuities. We consider an annuity of 1 per year annually to X, and it's an annuity due, so that means it's paid in the beginning of the period. It's paid to X and it is guaranteed for a period of N years. That means the payment is sure, independent of survival or not, for the first N years. The benefit cash flow then looks as follows. There is a payment of 1 at time K, where K goes from 0 to N minus 1. And then from time N on, there is a payment of 1 at time K lifelong. So the first N payments are guaranteed, are for sure. After the first N payments, so from time N on, the payment depends on survival. What is now the present value of this cash flow? The present value of this cash flow is the present value of the first sum is the N year term annuity certain, plus then the sum of V to the power K for all K is N to the beginning of the year of that kx. What is then the actuarial value of this cash flow? The actuarial value is the expectation of y. So this is a double dot n plus the value of a deferred annuity, so plus exn multiplied by a double dot xn. And this cash flow, this actuarial value, will be denoted by a double dot xn overlined. So there are two entities involved here, X and N. X lives for another TX years, random number of years, N exists for another N years. The overlining X and N means that the payment is made until the last of the two entities disappear. So it is for sure N years, N if X lives, survives N years, then it is until X dies. That's the meaning of this line over the X and N. It's a payment until the last of the two disappears. Then we can also have a look at the guaranteed annuity with monthly payments. That's very similar. That's an A double dot XN overlined 12 is a notation for an annuity with monthly payments of 1 over 12 for a period of N years, plus a deferred monthly annuity starting at age X plus N. Here is the timeline diagram for guaranteed annual annuity dues. So the payments are 1 starting at time 0, 1 forever. The discounted values are 1, V to the power 1, V to the power 2, V to the power N minus 1, and so on. What is the probability that the payments are made? The probability is 1, so it's sure that the payment will be made for the payments at time 0, time 1, time 2, and time N minus 1. And it's only after time N that survival of the insured is involved. Example 5.4. Please have a look at it by yourself. It's explained in detail in the book. Let us now have a look at increasing annuities. What is an increasing annuity? We start with arithmetically increasing annuities. We consider an increasing annuity due with the payment of T plus 1 at times T is 0, 1, 2, provided X is alive at time T. So if you look on the timeline, we have times 0, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the survival benefit, the benefit that is due in case of survival, at time 0 is 1, at time 1 is 2, at time 3 is 3, and so on. So how does the benefit cash flow look like? There is at time T, there is a payment T plus 1, provided the insured is still alive at time, and we sum over all T. What is then the actuarial value? We first have to take the present value and then the expectation of that present value. Well, let's have a look at any time t. At time t, there is a payment t plus 1. So the discounted value of the payment is V to the power T, T plus one, but this payment is only due if the insured is alive at time T, so we multiply by PXT. There is not only a payment at one time T, this is a payment at any time T between zero and infinity. So we end up with this sum of all these components to be the actuarial value of the increasing annuity. The increasing annuity is denoted by I A double dot X. I stands for increasing. And here is a timeline diagram that further explains, gives some insight in the amounts that are paid, the discounted values that are involved, and the probabilities that are involved. Now, we consider an arithmetically increasing annuity, but only with for a duration for a term of n years. So we consider an increasing annuity due with payments of t plus 1 at times 0, 1, 2 to n minus 1. So only in this time interval there are payments, provided x is alive at time t. The benefit cash flow looks similar to the whole life arithmetically increasing cash flow, except now that our sum goes from t is 0 to n minus 1. The last possible payment is at time n minus 1. What is then the actuarial value of this payment? There is a payment t plus 1 at time 1, at time t plus 1. The discounted value of it is v to the, sorry, there is a payment t plus 1 at time t. The discounted value of this payment is v to the power t multiplied by t plus 1. This payment is only due in case the insured survives, so we multiply by pxt. And then we have to sum over all time points where there will be a payment possible, and that is the time points from starting from t is 0 until t is n minus 1. Now we consider a continuous annuity, a continuous increasing annuity. We assume that the total payment is equal to t in the tth year. So in the year between 0 and 1, the first year there is a payment of 1. In the period, in the second year, the period between time 1 and 2, there is a payment of 2. But these payments are equally spread over the year, of course, provided x is alive. So how does the cash flow look like? Around time t, there is a payment of t plus 1, the floor function of it. So for instance, in the second year, there is a payment of 2. So therefore, we take the floor function here, and this payment is only due in case the insured is alive. So around time t, there is a payment t plus 1 floor multiplied by the indicator variable, meaning that the payment is only 1 in case the insured is alive, and the payment is not t plus 1 floor, but t plus 1 floor dt. Or we can rewrite the cash flow in another way. Around time t, there is a payment t plus 1 floor dt, and this holds for any time intervals, infinitesimal time intervals between 0 and the minimum of tx and n. What is then the actuarial value? The actuarial value is denoted by I A overlined x n. The A is overlined, meaning that the payments are continuous. The I is not overlined, meaning that the increase is discrete. So the first year there is a payment of 1, the second year there is a payment of 2, and so on. This actuarial value can be written as, in fact, a sum of 1 year term, m year deferred annuities. Indeed, in the year between m and m plus 1, between time m and m plus 1, there is a payment m plus 1, but this m plus 1 is continuously spread. So that's a continuous 1 year annuity, m year deferred. And how many of this 1 year deferred, how many of this m year deferred 1 year annuities do we have? We have n of them. We start with a deferral of 0 years, so an immediately start, until a deferral of n minus 1 years. Now we consider again this continuous annuity with the payment of t dt in the interval t t plus dt. So now there is not a constant payment in the continuous stream in the t tier, but the increase is also continuous. So a continuous annuity with the payment of TDT in the interval T, T plus DT, provided X is alive. So how is the cash flow looking now? So around time T, there is a payment TDT, provided the insured is alive. Or we can write this cash flow in another way. Around time T, there is a payment TDT, and this holds for any time T or for any interval T, T plus DT, between zero and minimum of Tx and n. So we have to sum over all these infinitesimal intervals, or that means we have to integrate here over all these intervals. The actuarial value then is given by the following expression. If there is a payment T dt around time T, the discounted value of this payment is T e to the power minus delta T dt, but this payment is only due in case the insured survive, so we have to multiply by Pxt. And we integrate this T e to the power minus delta T Pxt dt over all times between zero and time n. This actuarial value is denoted by I overlined, A overlined, X, N. The A overlined means that the payments are continuous. The I overlined means that the increasing effect is also continuous. Okay. Then here is a timeline diagram for the increasing continuous whole life annuity. So if we have this annuity here, it's continuously increasing. The payments are continuous and it is a lifelong annuity, then in the interval T, T plus DT, you receive TDT, discounted value. Discounting factor is e to the power minus delta T. The probability that you will receive it is Pxt. Okay. Let us now have a look at increasing annuities. For the geometrically increasing annuity, we have a payment at time zero, there is a payment of one, at time one, there is a payment of one plus j, at time two, there is a payment of one plus j squared, and so on. So j could be, for instance, an estimation of the future inflation, and the payment, the annuity payment, is adapted to the assumed inflation from year to year. So we have an annuity due with annual payments where the amount of the annuity is 1 plus j to the power t at times t is 0, 1 to n minus 1. So we assume it's an n year annuity. And of course the payment is only due in case the insured is alive. Our benefit cash flow now looks like as follows. At time t, there is a payment 1 plus j to the power t, but this payment is only due in case the insured is still alive at time t, and this holds for any times t between now and time n minus 1. Then the expected present value of this cash flow is equal to the left-hand side of this equation, 1 plus g to the power t discounted, so multiplied by v to the power t, n multiplied by pxt, because it's only due in case of survival, or you could say 1 plus g to the power t actuarially discounted, so that means multiplied by v to the power t pxt. Why actuarially discounted? Because the payment is only due in case of survival. And you sum here over all relevant values, so from t is 0 to n minus 1. The left-hand side is the expected present value of the cash flow stream that we just described. Now you can prove that this increasing annuity can be written as a constant annuity. We can write it as an n-year term constant annuity of amount 1, but with not with the technical interest I, but with an adapted interest I star, where I star is I minus j divided by 1 plus j. So this is a similar result to what we proved for increasing life insurances. So a geometrically increasing annuity can be written as a constant annuity, or better, the actuarial value of a geometrically increasing annuity can be written as the actuarial value of a constant annuity, if we adapt the interest. And here is an example, or better, here is a timeline diagram for this geometrically annuity, increasing annuity. Now, how we can evaluate annuity functions? Well, let omega be the first integer h x such that L omega is zero. So that omega is the first h at which nobody is alive in the life insurance portfolio or in the annuity portfolio. That means that q omega minus 1 is 1. Everybody of h omega minus 1 will for sure die in the coming year. We will set up a recursion to evaluate whole life annuities in a recursive way, a backward recursion. Let us start with the initial value. Suppose someone has h omega minus 1, so he is in the, he will for sure die in the next year. In this annuity due, the only payment that is due is a payment 1 immediate. And then next year there is no payment anymore because the insured has died. So the initial value, a double dot omega minus 1, is 1. And then let us have a look at the backward recursion. Means if we know a double dot x plus 1, let us from that calculate a double dot x. So if we know the annuity value for the x plus 1 year old person, how can we calculate the annuity value for an x year old person? This is explained on the next slide. So a double dot x here is in fact the expected present value of a series of survival benefits, namely 1, 1, 1, that you will receive forever every year in case you are surviving. And the yellow, the green arrow here means that we are evaluating at time zero. Now this whole series of payments, we split it in the first year. In the first year, there is a payment of 1 at time zero and the payments in the other years. So in the other years, there are payments at 1, there is a payment of 1, at 2, there is a payment of 1, and so on. Now, what is the expected present value of a payment of 1 at time 0? That is exactly equal to 1. And if we look now at the second cash flow here, we take the expected present value of a series of payments that starts only at time 1 in case of survival. So this cash flow is not equal, but is equivalent with a cash flow of receiving a double dot x plus 1 at time 1, provided you are still alive at time 1. So this whole series of payments from time 1 on, we replace that by one fixed payment at time 1, which you will receive provided you're still alive. If you're not alive anymore, there is nothing due anymore. The insurer doesn't have to pay anything. So this expected present value here is an expected present value of a payment, a survival payment of a double dot x plus 1 at time 1. What is the value at time 0? We have to actuarially discount this a double dot x plus 1. So we have to discount by V and multiply by the survival probability Px. And that gives us a formula 5.36 that a double dot x, the annuity, the actuarial value of an annuity lifelong to a person of age X is equal to an immediate payment of 1 plus an annuity to the person of age X plus 1 that will start in 1 year from now, but which is only due in case of survival. So multiplied by the actuarial 1 year discount factor, V multiplied by Px. This 5.36 is the yearly case. We can then also have a look at the monthly case. Let's say M is 12, so at the monthly case. If we are in the monthly case, we start at with the initial value, the price of a lifelong annuity on a person of age omega minus 1 over 12. So just 1 month younger than the maximal possible age. The cost of this annuity, there will only be a payment of 1 of M at time omega minus 1 of m, so the cost is 1 over m. And then we have a backward recursion. We can have a look at the value of the annuity at hx compared with the value of the annuity at hx plus 1 month extra. And this is the same recursion. The structure is exactly the same as in 5.36. But instead of working here in years, we work here in months. Okay. Now, there is another way to evaluate annuity functions using the uniform distribution of debt assumption. And we will have a look at it. So how do we evaluate? That's the question that we want to answer. The expected present value of a monthly and of a continuous annuity, given that we only have expected present values of yearly annuities. Well, you don't have to calculate too much anymore, because all the information is that we need to do the calculations are based on information that we have from before. Let's have a look. We know that under the uniform distribution of debt assumption, that the whole life insurance with pays at the end of the month of debt can be written as I over IM AX. And we also know that for a continuous whole life insurance under the uniform distribution of debt assumption, you can write it as I over delta times AX. So the monthly and the continuous whole life annuity can be expressed in terms of the yearly. The monthly and the continuous life insurance can be expressed as a life insurance with payments at the end of the year of debt. That's the first observation. Second observation, we know that there is a relation between annuities and life insurances, or between the actuarial values of annuities and cash flows. This holds for whole life yearly annuities, this holds for monthly annuities, and this also holds for continuous annuities. Well, taking into account this information, we can prove easily that under the uniform distribution of debt assumption, the monthly annuity, the actuarial value of the monthly annuity, can be written as alpha times the value of a yearly annuity minus beta m, where alpha m and beta m are given in 5.38. Well, here is a proof of 5.38 that AXM double dot, so the annuity due with monthly payments, can be expressed indeed as alpha times A double dot X minus beta M. Important here, please have a look at this proof by yourself, but important here is that the alpha M and the beta M are independent of X. Now let us have a look at some limiting values. One can prove that IM is the nominal interest rate with monthly payments. Well, the limit of IM for M going to infinity is delta. And the limit of the monthly discount factor DM for M going to infinity is also delta. That means that for a continuous annuity AX overlined under the uniform distribution of that assumption, we have the following approximation. It is ID divided by delta squared A double dot X minus I minus delta divided by delta squared. So the continuous annuity is expressed in terms of a yearly annuity. The proof of this is given here. So we know that the continuous annuity is in fact the monthly annuity, but it's in fact the monthly annuity, but discounted. Sorry, it's in fact the monthly annuity, but taking the limit for n going to infinity. And there is a small mistake here, which we have to correct. There should be no n here. Okay, so AX overlined is in fact the limit for m going to infinity of AX m. Now, for the monthly annuity under the uniform distribution of that assumption, we have an approximation. This monthly annuity can be written as alpha m times the yearly annuity minus beta m. Now we take the limit for m going to infinity of alpha m and beta m, and these values are respectively id divided by delta squared and I minus delta divided by delta squared. So that's indeed the approximation for the continuous annuity. Let us then have a look at the term annuity due. So we have now a term annuity with monthly payments. So we have an end-year term annuity with monthly payments of amount 1 over M. What is the approximation for this monthly annuity under the uniform distribution of debt assumption? This is also seen or proven in the next slide here. We write the term annuity as a whole life annuity minus a deferred whole life annuity. We take the approximations for the yearly and for the deferred annuity. So we know that A double dot XM can be written as alpha M A double dot X minus beta M. And because the alpha and the beta are independent of X, the same holds here for A double dot X plus NM. And reshuffling or rearranging the equations a little bit, we find indeed this expression that A double dot XNM is alpha M times A double dot XN minus beta M times 1 minus EXN. Now, some alpha M and beta M, we have expressions for them. Remember, the alpha M and the beta M were given by these expressions here. Well, if you have a look in exercise 5.19, you will see there that alpha M can be approximated by 1 and beta M can be approximated by M minus 1 over 2M. So that means that our approximation that we have for the term monthly annuity AXNM can be approximated by, we start from the uniform distribution of that assumption, and instead of using alpha M and beta M, we take the approximations for alpha M and beta M, and we end up with this expression 5.40, which is an expression and an approximation that is often used in practice. Let us then make the limit for M going to infinity. The year is split in M year, in M parts, and M goes to infinity. So we end up with infinitesimal small intervals. Then the monthly annuity or the mthly annuity becomes a continuous annuity. The A double dot XN remains the same. And M minus 1 divided by 2M will converge to 1 over 2. And then we have here our approximation for the continuous annuity. We can also evaluate annuity functions with another formula, with Woolhouse's formula, but please read that in the book. This is not part of the exam. And then there is a numerical illustration here. We take as mortality the standard ultimate survival model. The interest is 0.1, so it's 10%. And we look at the exact value of a monthly annuity for 10 years with payments of 1 over 12 per month under an interest of 10%. What is the exact value here? What is the value under the UDD assumption? And what is the value under the WT approximation? Well, the exact value corresponds to this value. The UDD approximation in this table here is in fact formula 5.39, and the W2 approximation is in fact formula 5.40. And you will see that these approximations work are rather similar, give the approximations perform very well and are very close to each other. The same holds for another setting. We have now an annuity for a term of 25 years with every 6 months a payment of 1/2. And we take now an interest of 5%. We look at the exact calculation, the calculation under the UDD assumption and the approximation under the W2 assumption. And these approximations are in fact formula 5.39 and formula 5.40. And we compare the exact values with the approximated values, and you will see that they are very similar. W3 and W3 prime are Woolhouse formula approximations, and as I said, this is not material that you have to study. Then functions for select lives. Throughout this chapter, we assumed an ultimate survival model. So we assumed that mortality only depends on the attained age, not on the time since selection. But all the results that we have derived can easily be then adapted to the case of a select survival model. Let us give some examples. So let us consider, for instance, a continuous life annuities and endowment insurances. We have a life annuity, a continuous life annuity, on a person of age X plus K years for N years. So there is a constant payment of one per year, continuously spread over the year. And the person is now age X plus K. He was selected K years ago. Well, this actuarial value can be expressed as an integral of discounted values multiplied by survival probabilities. This is just a generalization of a formula that we have seen in this chapter. The same we knew already, an endowment insurance can also be written in four select lives. So we have here a continuous endowment insurance on a person of age X plus K years for a duration of N years. And this is an expression that we know from the previous chapter. Now, we have seen in this chapter that there is a relation between annuities and life insurance actuarial values. Well, this formula remains to hold in under select lives, for select lives. The only thing that you have to take care of is in the left-hand side and the right-hand side, it's about the same person. So the person is selected at life at age X. So X is between brackets here. Then also here, X has to be between brackets. That's the first generalized relation. Other example, let us have a look at yearly and monthly life annuities. So a yearly life annuity on a select life of age X plus K, who was selected K years ago, its actuarial value is sum over all t v to the power t p x plus k t, and where the x is here between brackets, because also here x is between brackets. The same holds for a monthly annuity. The monthly annuity on a person of age x plus k who was selected k years ago, well, this actuarial value can be expressed by this infinite sum, where there is a survival probability on a person of age x plus k, and x is between brackets, of course, here too. And then, if you remember, we had approximations for instance, the monthly annuity on a person of age X plus K. Well, this monthly approximation, this approximation of this monthly annuity, and under the uniform distribution of that assumption, could be written as a function of yearly annuities. This holds under a select, also holds for select lives. So this is just an immediate generalization of what we have seen before for ultimate lives. And remember, we have seen that the alpha m and the beta m can be approximated. Well, also for select lives, this holds, and then you get this approximation. So summarizing, all formulas, all relations that we have seen, all kinds of annuities that we have defined in this chapter, this can all be generalized to select lives. Only be careful that if you select the life at age X, then in any formula, in any relation, the X has to be between brackets in the left-hand side and in the right-hand side. Then there is an interesting example, 5.6. Please have a look at it by yourself, and the notes and further reading section 5.14 also read that in the book. Thank you for your attention. This was the end of chapter 5.